Poor thing.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us this morning here at North Leamington United Mennonites. My name is Chris Hutton. I'm the lead pastor here at North Leamington, and it's post-Easter, so it's always nice to see folks coming out after the Easter holidays. I've also been trying to decide if this is good weather. It seems like it's 3 degrees outside. I need my jacket in the morning, but by the time the afternoon comes around, that jacket's gone, and I'm losing my sweater, and it gets warmer by the middle of the afternoon. Just some things to let you know about that are coming up in our church community over the next little while. One is that our home churches will be off this week for various things that they're up to. I believe Joanne Brown also has an announcement for us.
Good morning. I'm here on behalf of the missions team to provide an update for you. We're so grateful again for all who have contributed to our projects locally and internationally through MCC. And I wanted to let you know a couple of updates from MCC. One is related to the situation in Gaza. Although there was the tragedy early this week, MCC was able to report that they have been able to get food assistance into Gaza through a crossing in Jordan. So after 3 weeks of unsuccessfully navigating the complicated logistics of the Rafah crossing, they were able to get one truckload of food through. Additional shipments are planned for 2,000 families that have exceptional needs in central Gaza. And this project is part of a $1.6 million project funded through MCC's account at Canadian Food Grains Bank and includes matching funds from the Government of Canada and donors that have given to MCC's emergency response to Gaza. That's us, you, we. MCC continues to advocate strongly for a ceasefire, adherence to international humanitarian law, and for a long-term just peace. We do too. MCC has also reported that aid is getting to those in dire need in Myanmar, our Easter time project. Food, medical supplies, and shelter supplies are being distributed through local partners through generous gifts of over $300,000 during that last few weeks of the Easter season. Thanks to everyone who contributed to this important work of MCC. Those of you who attended Walter's funeral on Friday and met their Karen family may be aware that those Karen families emigrated from Myanmar. We are also grateful for those who are able to seek freedom here in Canada and elsewhere in the world, and for the amazing support of people like Walter and Marlene and the Leamington Area Ecumenical Refugee Committee. Speaking of local projects, our Pascha sale was a great success. $710 was raised, and a check will be delivered to the Leamington Salvation Army Food Bank this week. Our Change is Good project continues to go amazingly well, with over $850 donated so far. Amazing, a bit of pocket change can add up to. We will continue to support this project through to the end of June in partnership with the Sunday School. Can we hit $1,000? We think so. Thanks to everyone again for your kind and generous support of these projects.
Thanks, Joanne. Yeah, it was certainly astonishing at Walter Dick's memorial this week, seeing the impact that he and Marlene had on the Karen community, their history sponsoring refugees, bringing families to Canada. I think at one point there was an adult choir of about 20, maybe more than that, people at one point singing a song about Jesus' hope and love in the light of what Walter had done with his life. It was amazing. Let's join together in reading this call to worship as we begin our time of worship this morning. Shouts of joy, songs of praise, sounds of hope and love.
These are moments of thanksgiving, giving thanks to our God.
Adonai is our God, our Creator. We are God's people, led by God's love.
These are moments of thanksgiving, giving thanks to our God.
Enter God's house giving thanks. Enter God's house full of praise.
These are moments of thanksgiving, giving thanks to our God.
God's love is never ending.
God is good. Hallelujah.
Let's stand together as we sing Voices Together, number 64, As Long as Jesus' Reign Goes On. Please stand. Seated. Our ushers are going to come forward at this moment to take our offering this morning. If you're here visiting with us this morning, please don't feel obliged to give. You're welcome to give if you like, but we don't necessarily expect our guests to give when they visit us on a Sunday morning. Those of us who attend North Leamington regularly, we give of what we have so that we can offer things like having this space available for families like Marlene and Walters, having a space for their family to remember their loved one and have a time of tribute to them. We're going to stay seated and sing together, Voices Together, number 131, Praise, I Will Praise You, Lord, while the offering is taken. Let's pray together. Lord, we take time to pause amidst our week to recognize your love and the wonders of your glory in our lives and in the world around us. Lord, as we share our gifts this morning, we ask that they would be examples of us to love, serve, to bring your light into the world around us. We give of what we have, whether that's our time, our relationships, our finances, things you have blessed us with, because we long to be a part of that blessing to others. And so as we give today, we give with our hearts, with a sense of the joy that you've shared with us, and in worship of your grace and mercy, to be a light to the world around us. And I pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. I'll invite the children to come forward for a children's story. Good morning. Oh, how are you doing this morning? Good. How are you doing post-Easter? Do you still have chocolate? Yes. My daughter, when she was your age, she would get a bunch of chocolate and she would hoard it in her room. And around November, we'd be like, why is there still chocolate in your room? She said, because I want to enjoy it later. Well, how long is later? She kept chocolate forever. Hey, I have a question for you. What do you think separates us, human beings, from jellyfish? What's a big difference between us and jellyfish, would you say? Yes, Bodhi. Ooh, they can sting, can't they? Good thing we can't sting, eh? That'd be nasty. What else do you think is a difference between us and jellyfish? Yes. They live underwater, that's right. Do you think jellyfish have bones? They don't, do they? But we have bones, don't we? Did you know you have 206 bones in your body, and over half of them are in your hands and in your feet? That's pretty crazy, eh? Did you know when you were born, you had 300 bones in your body? What happened to the extra bones? Why do you have less bones now, do you think? Any guesses? Yes, Bodhi. Because you're older. That's a good answer. Because you're older. As you get older, some of your bones fuse together to become one bone. Like in your head, when you're born as a newborn baby, there's four different pieces up here that aren't joined together. And as you grow older, they fuse together to make a skull. That's why newborn babies' heads are so soft when they're born. What do you think is the biggest bone in the human body? If you had to guess the biggest bone in the human body, what would you say? These guys are like, I'm coming to church for a biology lesson today? What's happening? Take a guess. Where do you think the biggest bone is? Yes, Lucy. The rib? That's a good guess. It isn't. Try again. What do you think? The rib's a good guess. What might be even longer or bigger? How about the top of your leg? It's your femur bone is your biggest bone. Do you know where the smallest bone is? You can guess. Yes, Bodhi. Oh, that's a good guess. There's one even smaller inside your ear. It's called a stapes bone. That's a funny name, eh? So what do your bones do for you? Why do you have bones in your body? How do they help you out? They help us move. They help us stand. We'd be like jellyfish if we didn't have the bones, right? How do you keep your bones healthy? Do your parents ever tell you you have to eat certain things to keep your bones healthy? Yep, Bodhi. Drinking milk? Well done, cornies. Bodhi knows his bone health. Yeah, it's true. You have to drink milk. So the same way that we do things to keep our body bones healthy, there's things that we do in church to keep our faith healthy. Things like reading the Bible, praying together, being here in church, doing community together in church. These are the things we do to keep the bones of our faith kind of strong, so that when difficult times come along, we know what to do. Just like you have to keep your bones healthy so your body can be strong during tough times, the bones of our faith have to be kept strong too,
So when we go through difficult times, we'll be able to get through. Let's pray together, okay? Lord, please help to keep the bones of our faith strong so we can stand tall for you. And we pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Thanks, guys. You go to Sunday school.
Well, from that, we transition to our scripture reading this morning, which comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 29. I'll be reading verses 4 to 9 and 16 to 19. But to this day, the Lord has not given you minds that understand, nor eyes that see, nor ears that hear. For 40 years I led you through the wilderness, yet your clothes and sandals did not wear out. You ate no bread and drank no wine or other alcoholic drink, but he provided for you, so you would know that he is the Lord your God. When we came here, King Sihon of Heshbon and King Og of Bashan came out to fight against us, but we defeated them. We took their land and gave it to the tribes of Reuben and Gad and to the half-tribe of Manasseh as their grant of land. Therefore, obey the terms of this covenant so that you will prosper in everything you do. You remember how we lived in the land of Egypt and how we traveled through the lands of enemy nations as we left. You've seen their detestable practices and their idols made of wood, stone, silver, and gold. I'm making this covenant with you so that no one among you, no man, woman, clan, or tribe, will turn away from the Lord our God to worship these gods of other nations, and so that no root among you bears bitter and poisonous fruit. Those who hear the warnings of this curse should not congratulate themselves, thinking I'm safe, even though I'm following the desires of my own stubborn heart. This would lead to utter ruin. And now I'm excited to introduce to you Troy Osborne, professor of history at Conrad Grebel. We're talking today about how do I do a proper introduction for Professor Osborne this morning. I have a connection with Conrad Grebel. It's where I first discovered Mennonites. Was when I was an undergraduate going to University of Waterloo, and I took courses at Conrad Grebel. So Conrad Grebel played a very important part in my journey of becoming a Mennonite. Like today, we've been sharing stories of professors that some of us have had in the past, people we've known from our time at Conrad Grebel. But Grebel actually offers a program called Grebel to Go, which is excellent branding. The idea being that MCC churches can reach out to Conrad Grebel professors and have them come and share with us on a Sunday morning. And so I reached out to Troy in particular about coming and speaking, because we'd had a couple of conversations about history of Mennonites, and I'd shared that we'd just recently done a sermon series on Anabaptists and the history of Anabaptists. So I asked if he'd be interested in coming to share, and lo and behold, he still showed up. So Troy, I'll invite you to come and share with us.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you for the invitation to join you this morning. As I love visiting churches and seeing how other people worship and pray together. And it looks like I might need to start with an apology because I may have given you the wrong verses to read. Yeah, it was 26. That is what I have. So I'm going to go ahead and read the verse today, and then jump on in with it. So if you have your Bibles, you could turn to Deuteronomy 26, 4 to 9, and verses 16 to 18, but I'll read them to you, and then you can look them up later. So they may be familiar. So this is from the book of Deuteronomy. After it follows a list of commandments from the priest that the people of Israel are supposed to do, and then they talk about what you're supposed to do when you go into the temple. And it goes this way. This is when you give your first fruits, when you give your offering. Chris talked a little bit about why we give offerings to the church. And this is what the priestly writers are saying to the people of Israel. When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before the Lord your God. This is the part that I wanted to talk about today. A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, a few in number, and then he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us, by imposing hard labor on us, we cried out to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. And the Lord heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. The Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power and with signs and wonders. And he brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So that's some of those phrases you may have sung before, you may have heard refer to this. So the second part then. So this very day, the Lord your God is commanding you to observe these statutes and ordinances. So observe them diligently with all your heart and all your soul. Today, you have attained the Lord's agreement to be your God and for you to walk in his ways, to keep his statutes, his commandments, and his ordinances, and to obey him. Today, the Lord has obtained your agreement to be his treasured people, as he promised you, and to keep all his commandments, for him to set you high above all nations that he has made in praise and in fame and honor, for you to be a people holy to the Lord your God, as he promised. So before I get into the sermon, then just so you hear what happened, right? The people of Israel are to reflect on the good things that God has done in the past for them, and then this leads into the basis of their relationship with God. God is going to be their God, they are going to be his people, and they are going to keep his statutes and ordinances. So I'll just to begin today, I told Chris I could give a little fuller introduction of myself. I do teach history at Conrad Grable, which is part of the University of Waterloo. I've been there for about 13 years, and I like it. I'm the dean now as well, so I teach a little less than I would like, but I get to help other people teach and research and do administration better. I'm originally an American from Kansas, but I've lived over half my life in other countries. My parents worked for MCC in the West Bank and Egypt and Jordan, and I also lived in Europe as well. Much of my research is on Anabaptist history of thought, especially the history in the Netherlands, Dutch Anabaptist history. And I recently completed a new textbook on Anabaptist history. So it's not like a history encyclopedia of everything that happens, but it's supposed to be a book that people could read and use in the classroom that's accessible to students. So that's the goal that I wrote it with. There's a lot of stories I had to leave out, but I hope it's one that students find something that they can read in class that's accessible to them. It was a fascinating class. I had a task to write this book. I had other Mennonite history profs help me do it, because they want to use it as well. And there's nothing more humbling than to have your friends and your peers read your book and tell you what you're doing wrong. It's a good reminder of what it's like to be a student, and it's a good lesson in humility. But it was hard. I don't say that to ask people sympathy, but it's 500 years of history into 15 chapters, and it's now a story that has spread over six continents. There's no one in Antarctica yet. Six continents. So it's hard to make a story that's easily digestible, that people who may not have any background in history or Mennonites or Anabaptists can find use of. But as I was writing this book, I found that my mind would often turn to this passage for sort of why am I doing it? Why is history important? When students take my class at the master's level at Conrad Grable, they have to take a history class. I know it's not going to be their favorite class. I try to make it their favorite class by the end, but they start off not thrilled about it. But I say, why do we study history in the church? Like, why is the study of history important? Not just if you're Mennonite, but for Christians in general. And this is a verse that I often think about. It's not one that I heard often growing up in Mennonite churches in South Central Kansas. The first time I encountered the story of the wandering Aramean was in a Bible class at Heston College, where my professor used it as the sort of key phrase to unlock the start of the relationship between God and the people of God. It's this memory that God acts in history, and out of gratitude for the things God has done, we follow God's commandments. It's pretty straightforward, but it's an act of memory. The Israelites were to remember the Lord their God, what God had done for them. Now, the wandering Aramean, you may say, who is that? That's what I said when I read this passage. So apparently some people think it was Jacob, because he wandered and his sons are the ones that go into Egypt. But I think that Hebrew scholars say it may even be Abraham who wandered into the land of Canaan. That doesn't matter so much as the story that that passage wants to tell. Hearing the Israelites' voice and seeing their affliction, toil, and oppression, God brought them out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm and brought them into a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, for that class, we actually had to memorize that passage. There were like four passages we had to memorize. So that was one that we had. So we would somehow always make jokes. If we asked people to pass stuff in the cafeteria, we'd say, please do it with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. So there we go. But the point is that the Israelites were to give gratitude to God for all that God has done, walk in God's way, and keep God's statutes. And this story was written by what's called the authors wrote this 600 years after the Exodus. So they were telling history. They're writing it at a time that's even further away from the start of Anabaptism. Even though they had no direct memory of the event, they understood that God's acts in history were at the heart of their faith. And then this idea of telling a story continues over time in the Jewish and Christian traditions. Over time, followers of Christ who are no longer Jewish, but Greek, German, Ojibwe, Somali, they've understood that the story of the wandering Aramean is their story too, even if Abraham wasn't their direct biological ancestor. So we all give thanks to God, not just for the great things that God has done in our lives, but also for God's mighty hand with the Arameans centuries and millennia ago. And there's a nice humbling effect of this, right? It's a good reminder that our story isn't tied to one country or to one people or to one tradition. It's a universal story. And it's a powerful idea that runs through Christian history, Christian theology. Christianity is a religion that assumes God acts in history. This is scandalous to some religions, right? We just celebrated Easter, which is probably the most important historical event that Christians lay claim to, that God enacted in history to resurrect Jesus from the grave. So from Exodus to Jesus, to the formation of the church, God has been working to reconcile humanity to God and to each other. The Israelites, the people of Judah, Jesus, the early church, and our church have all said, this is our story too. The Aramean is our wandering ancestor. God acts in history. Now, Chris mentioned before, and my understanding is that you as a congregation have recently been studying Anabaptist history and identity. So I assume part of the invitation is that you see this as your story as well. And what I'd like to talk to you today is what it means for us to say we are part of the Anabaptist story. So you've already done work on this, so I'm not actually going to go into the details. I'm not going to give you a little Anabaptist history lesson from the front, although a little bit at the end. But what I'd like to do is think with you theologically about what it means to say we're part of a tradition. And you could think Mennonite tradition, but you could also just think Christianity in general. What might it mean to say that our fathers, our mothers were wandering Arameans, wandering Argentinians, wandering Ukrainians, when God acts in their lives to save us? And I think it's important to do this. I'll start with two reasons, and then I'll kind of go into detail on it. One reason that this is important is because it says that the body of Christ, the church, extends through time and space, right? It's not just the local church, it's not MCEC, it's all of Christians throughout time and throughout space. And when we take communion, one of the things that we do is we say, we're not just taking it with all Christians around the world now, but we are in communion with the saints that have gone before us. So I'd love that idea. I'm a historian, so clearly I love history stuff. But the idea that we're part of a body of people who have gone before us. And the second is that Christianity and history reminds us that theology is not an abstract idea. It can be, but it's always been acted out in people. It's always been lived out. Right? It's easy when we talk about Anabaptism or Christianity to only focus on the good parts, the parts that have been that are role models to us. It's too easy to just look at the pure and the best. Some of you may remember Stuart Murray's book, The Naked Anabaptist, that was kind of popular a few years ago. I don't know, did that make it here, the Naked Anabaptist. It's where Stuart says, I'm going to get rid. Stuart Murray is somebody who's come into the Anabaptist tradition as a convert. He's writing in England, and what he does is he tries to separate out kind of Anabaptist teachings from the history of particular Mennonites and Amish people. And I say, well, I understand what he's doing to help it make sense in England, but Anabaptism's never been naked. It's always been lived out by people, right? I'm interested in fully clothed Anabaptists. And how have they got it right? How have they got it wrong? So it's a lesson in humility for Christians to think about ourselves as part of a tradition, because there's lots of times where Christians get it wrong. The other thing that I'll tell a couple of examples of is that it reminds us that Christianity has become a global faith. Several years ago, there was a pastor, Huyen Hong Quang, who was a pastor of the Evangelical Mennonite Church in Vietnam. He was severely beaten after he left his house to head to evening worship. He was traveling on a motorcycle with a fellow pastor when seven strangers attacked him with clubs and bricks. And before he lost consciousness, Pastor Quang recognized two of the attackers. He had seen them sort of suspiciously lingering around the church in the weeks before, suggesting they were undercover police officers. The church that Pastor Quang is part of as a member is not actually officially recognized by the Vietnamese state. It's come under attack before. In 2015, 300 to 500 police officers, plainclothes officers, and local defense forces raided the theological center in Ho Chi Minh City at night, arresting all the Bible students who were spending the night there. Now, that's an interesting story, right? I'd love hearing the story about the work that you were already supporting at MCC, because what attracted me about this story, that I had this aha, that this profound moment of feeling the Holy Spirit linking me with this global body, was that this story was shared in the Canadian Mennonite, the magazine of the Mennonites in Canada. And this was in my Facebook feed. Historically, Mennonites have stressed the local congregation, right? It's the local church where we read scripture together, we sing hymns together as we did this morning, we eat potlucks, we pray with one another, and we celebrate our joys and we mourn our sorrows together. And perhaps it's in the local congregation that in small Bible groups where we pray and we read scripture together to know and discern who we truly are in this context. Therefore, I just found it remarkable that we feel this urge to help Christians around the world, Mennonites around the world, a continent away, 500 years away from a European origin, that's as it started out. The church in Vietnam is also part of the body of Christ. They are also wandering Arab. Their father is also a wandering Aramaean. Another example, more recently, a call's gone out to help support the Anabaptist congregations in the Democratic Republic of Congo. There's nearly 1.5, probably 2 million people by now displaced by armed conflict there. They need food, household items, and shelter supplies. This response was requested by the Congolese Mennonite and Mennonite Brethren churches and coordinated by MCC and supported by Mennonite and Canadian U.S. organizations. And then very recently, a leader of the Church of Ethiopia sent a request for help because the war in Ukraine, the high cost of gas and fuel, is affecting the Ethiopian church and contributing to the famine there. So part of what I want to think about is how, when we say we're part of the same body, does this make us, this gives us obligations to people across the world. So I believe that saying that we are part of a historical people gives us a vision we can follow. It makes us connected to people across the world. But it's a tradition that we need to approach carefully. So I'm glad that you've already had your introduction to it. So maybe as you think about what it means for you to live into an Anabaptist identity in the 21st century, you will do this together. So just like the Bible, I tell my students, it takes discernment. You have to think carefully about it. We have a very good sense of how we relate to people here, right? And maybe to the generation or two that came before us. Congregational historians are the gems of the churches because they can tell you the history of every single thing that happened at your local congregation. But what it means to be a part of a church is not always clear. Mennonites don't have a pope to guide us to say this is true, this is not true. We don't actually have an official set of beliefs that everyone has to sign on to or agree to. We have a confession of faith, but in some churches you have to give your allegiance or you have to sign an oath of agreement with a confession to join or to be a minister. So this is one of the things that I always find funny when people join the Mennonite church. They get really frustrated when they realize that there is no sort of agreement about what it means to be a Mennonite. There's sort of this moment of shock when they say, you Mennonites, you Anabaptists can believe anything. You don't agree on anything. And I kind of say, well, if you only knew. So this gets me back to my textbook. So one of the things that became clear as I worked on my textbook is that this is a question that Anabaptists and Mennonites have been asking for centuries. Right? This is not a new moment of crisis for the church. They've been constantly asking this, who are we? Who are we? You know, the Bible says this, but what is this going to mean for us to live it out? Who are we in relationship with? As context changed, Mennonites and Anabaptists are constantly being pulled and pushed and stretched to figure out what that means. There are new spiritual wells to drink from, and so they don't always agree about what those definitions are. So I find it really interesting to study the history of the church. You have men and women from nowadays, we have men and women outside our traditional ethnic Mennonite groups, or cultural Mennonite groups, I should say, who find the tradition theologically rich and helpful. It's a good way to make sense of a world that where not everyone is Christian anymore. Anabaptist networks are springing up in Great Britain, Korea, New Zealand, Australia, South Africa. Southern Baptists have recently held an Anabaptist theology conference, and the megachurch pastor Rick Warren has said that Anabaptism is the biggest influence on his purpose-driven life and ministry. Similarly, the former president of the Southern Baptist Convention, Paige Patterson, has publicly said they are an Anabaptist group as well. In Africa and Asia, Anabaptism has experienced its most remarkable growth since its beginning, and most of that growth has happened in our lifetime. Actually, really, even within the last 30 years. In North America, the Amish church is expected to double every 20 years, so there will probably be 1 million Amish men and women, Old Order Amish men and women, in just a few years from now. There are 2.7 million baptized Anabaptists in the world, and Mennonite Church Canada and Mennonite Church US make only 9% of that global total. So, what does this mean then? Who are we? What is this global church? And this is the story that I had to try and figure out and put together in a book. And I'm not sure that I cracked it. So I just kind of said, well, people who are Anabaptist are the people who say they are Anabaptist. It's not a clear answer, but it's a beginning point. So I just say to some, how do we do this then? How do we think about who is going to be part of it? And maybe it's easy for this congregation because we already live in a world where people choose what faith they become part of. But we need to be careful how we use that story. History is not an easy guide. It can also be used as a weapon. The Bible, when we study the Bible, you know, requires study, requires praying and discernment and community together. We check with each other saying, am I getting this right? Am I understanding this right? The scripture's a little bit not clear to me. How do you see it? Right? I think we should do the same thing when we read history, because history doesn't solve problems. During COVID, people who did not want to wear masks to worship or to do business wrote letters to Conrad Grebel saying that we were betraying the Anabaptist tradition by asking students, because we were part of the Waterloo, we actually didn't have a choice, but we got letters saying that we had betrayed Anabaptism because we were not respecting this tradition in Anabaptism of saying no, of not going along with the crowd. They said, those of us who are saying no, whether it's about vaccines or masks, they saw themselves as being true to Anabaptism. At the same time, other Anabaptists were making claims that the thing to do to care for your neighbor, to look for justice, is to get vaccinated and wear a mask. But they were both appealing to the same tradition. You can also see people appealing to that radical saying no tradition in their protest for Gaza, right? They're saying that Anabaptists have a tradition of saying no to governments and living it out. So it's a story that you can use that isn't always clear. Anabaptism has both violent apocalyptic radicals who expected the end time to come at any moment, but it also has quiet farmers who retreated from the world just to wanted to be left alone in peace. Our task, your task, is to work together at discerning what it's going to mean to be claim that our father is a wandering Aramean, or to claim that we are an Anabaptist congregation. And I'm not going to give you those, I'm going to give you some hints today, but I think you should work at that together, and it sounds like you already have. What does it mean to want to walk in God's way, to keep God's statutes, to follow God's commandments and God's ordinances, and to obey God in response to what God has done in the Anabaptist tradition? In a year from now, we're going to be gathering in Zurich, Switzerland, to commemorate 500 years of Anabaptism, right? And so what part of that process has been 10 years of events gathered across the world where people say, what does this even mean today? Who are we? What does it mean to be an Anabaptist? I believe you've used Palmer Becker's book. Palmer goes to my church, so his idea is that Jesus is the center of our faith, community is the center of our life, and reconciliation is the center of our work. So those are really good places to start. Palmer asked me for sort of what I thought about his book, and I think he's a good start of us today. So I'm going to give you some ideas about what I see based on the book that I just finished. One is that Anabaptists sought to follow Christ in daily life. Right? They wanted to live it out. And that's partly why they didn't become Lutherans or Calvinists, is because they said, well, everyone's claiming to be Reformed, but we don't see the fruits of the Spirit. That's the phrase they often use. We don't see the fruits. Where are the fruits? This is a good part of the country to be looking for fruit, I guess. Even those who persecuted the Anabaptists, who hated them, had to admit the Anabaptists lived pretty upright lives. There's a story of a man being arrested because he didn't get drunk. He didn't carry a sword on him, and he didn't swear. So people said, you must be an Anabaptist, because you lived a good life. He's like, no, I don't do those things. I'm not an Anabaptist, believe me. So discipleship, that's one thing that I see. That's an answer, but it's an answer we have to discern. But to help us do that is the second thing that I see in Anabaptism. And this is something that Palmer doesn't emphasize probably enough, is that they prayed. They really emphasized the Holy Spirit. This sometimes surprises and disappoints my progressive students in the classroom because they get uncomfortable when I talk about the Holy Spirit, but this is what the Anabaptists constantly made claims to the Holy Spirit, that they claimed that what they were doing was not just biblically inspired, but because the Holy Spirit had got to them to that place. And sometimes it led them to things like literally being naked Anabaptists and walking through the streets of Amsterdam or burning all their clothes and things like that. But I tell my students that the reason they emphasize the Holy Spirit is because it's what gives them the authority to do what they do, right? They're saying, well, we don't have a pope, we don't have Martin Luther, but we have the Holy Spirit. So I think prayer is going to be part of the discernment for Anabaptists. Reading the Bible, they all read the Bible, they all had access to it. Even if they couldn't read themselves, they would read it out loud and discern it together. This is one of the things that, again, their opponents saw, and they hated. They said, there were spies at an Anabaptist meeting, and they said, everybody there talked about the Bible like they were experts on it. And they said, it made me want to throw up, because it was so gross. And the last thing that I think I see among all Anabaptists is an emphasis to care for one another, right? Part of discipleship was what we might call mutual aid today. So I really loved coming here today after I hear an announcement of some of the work that you've already done to support MCC, and also then the support that you give each other at a funeral. Like, that is classic Anabaptist mutual aid, right? It's not just an individual feeling good about themselves with the Holy Spirit. Discipleship's not just about not drinking and carrying a sword, but discipleship's about reconciling, to use Palmer's word, but it's about mutual aid for one another. One of the earliest opponents of this Swiss Anabaptist wrote that the early Anabaptists, and this is his words now, they tried to be like the early Christians to practice community of goods. They broke the locks off their doors, chests, and cellars. They ate food and drink in good fellowship without discrimination. They invited their brothers and sisters to share food and drink and shelter and worship from one household to the next. And then you have other extremes like the Hutterites, where they literally held everything in common. But the historians now say that even more than nonviolence, what Anabaptists agreed about was that we need to care for one another. So how do we then move from that 16th century Anabaptism to today? One of the things that I wanted to do in my book was not move too quickly from the 16th century to today. There have been 500 years where the descendants of the Anabaptists, either the spiritual descendants, people who joined the movement, or the people who've been with the movement for 400 years, have tried to live out Anabaptist principles. The story that sometimes, the shorthand story, often focuses on those initial Anabaptist years, and then jumps to maybe the 20th century, when Anabaptists came to North America, built a bunch of colleges. It skips over a lot of stuff, is what I'm saying. A lot happened in those intervening 400 years. Why do we skip over those middle parts? Right? So this is the part when I teach Mennonite history that students want me to go faster on, because they either want to stay in the golden age or they want to get to the present. And I say, well, no, let's look at what happened in between. Why do people want to skip it? I think one reason that they skip it is that we need ideals. We need a vision, right? There's a human need to tell a story that inspires us. I get it, right? We need to have something to hold out before us that we can work towards. So I think it's a very human impulse. And I don't criticize that need to do it. But I think that we move too quickly if we look over the point where people get it wrong, right? My students, I gave a sermon a couple weeks ago with a bunch of Grable students in Niagara, and I said, I'd love the New Testament stories of people getting it wrong, because they are the people that knew Jesus directly, right? And they just don't understand what Jesus is doing. I think it gives us some grace to get it wrong as well. That doesn't mean we don't try, but we have to realize that there are mistakes in our past and in the history of the church. So we need to acknowledge those, we need to embrace those as part of our discernment process. So while it's important, I think that all of us need to figure out what we keep and what we discard, right? It's especially, I think a lot of us today are thinking about how cultural practices like food or a common language are ways to keep a group together, but they can also be a way to keep people out. I was just thinking that at Easter, when I first moved to KW, they were talking about Pascha at church. And I said, sorry, what are you talking about? They said, Pascha, you know, Pascha. And I said, sorry, I don't. And they said, oh, are you new to the Mennonite tradition? And I'm like, oh, no. They said, oh, you don't know Russian Mennonites. I said, I am from Kansas, where 20,000 Mennonites lived. And so it was an interesting opportunity to talk about history. But it was an interesting thing where Pascha was a beloved tradition in this church. But for a Swiss Mennonite like me, I just was like, I don't know what that means. What are you talking about? So I didn't make it, but I made hot crust buns instead, because I knew that. So it's important for us to acknowledge that Anabaptism is more than an ideal. It's been lived out. It's not pure. There's been lots of mistakes. And I see it all the time, right? I want to prepare people for that disappointment. The real embodied church is made up of sinners like me, like you, like everybody. We will never be pure or idealized. The challenge is for us to discern what's worthy of keeping and sustaining and what needs to be adapted to our new context. It should not be a rush to quickly cut off any of the traditional Mennonite practices, but it actually remains unclear about the future of the church and Christianity in general. It's important to remain with an understanding of where we have come from, instead of simply leaping from one trend to the next in the vain hope of becoming truly relevant and trendy. So what's it going to mean for you to be Mennonite or Anabaptist? Well, I would say you can't simply transplant Anabaptism to today. Of course you can't. We live in a democracy. We have better healthcare. We don't speak German. But I think you can't go wrong if you focus on the things that the early church focused on: reading the Bible, prayer, discipleship, and mutual aid. This is like the four legs of a chair that need to be balanced, If one is stressed more than the other, if it's too much about discipline and not enough about the Holy Spirit, the chair gets balanced and topples over. And just remember, as you discern to do this, that God has done amazing things for you, that you are loved by God, and that you follow God because God has loved you. So we do this not out of fear as you face the future, but out of gratitude, giving ourselves grace to get it wrong along the way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Troy, for sharing that message this morning. It's also nice to know, so in getting the passage wrong this morning, I was just giving you an illustration on when Christians get it wrong. Is that the... And I'm also going to be checking my sixes and my nines now when I read Bible verses. Let's stand together as we sing this next song, Alleluia. Please stand. May be seated. Now, have some time. If anyone would like to share any requests for prayer, items of joy to celebrate, or items of concern that you would like prayer for, if you'd like to share a prayer request, you can raise your hand and our ushers will get a microphone to you and give you a chance to share.
Good morning, Barbara Martins here. I'm so grateful that the efforts that MCC is making to get material aid to places like Myanmar and Gaza were successful this past week. But also keeping in mind, please, prayers for the safety of the aid workers, both international as well as local, because they have faced great threats to do this humanitarian work.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Thank you, Barb. All right, let's pray together this morning. Lord, as we remember the great cloud of witnesses that you've gathered, overall in our larger Christian family, but also within our Anabaptist family, we give you thanks for the bravery of individuals who are willing to step into difficult places in the world to bring help, to bring aid, to bring assistance. Lord, we are thankful for them because we recognize that not all of us have received that call, or not all of us have the ability to go to these places. And so we give of what we can to support those who are representing and serving in that way. We wish to give of our resources to support them and to proclaim that we recognize them. We realize the work that they are doing on our behalf as part of our larger church family. Lord, we give thanks for the things that Troy has shared with us here this morning in terms of the history of people who have embodied your love in the world around us as an example of our desire for mutual aid as a church family. Thank you for how you have acted throughout history in this regard, how you gave examples in early Anabaptism, examples that proceeded through later years, in centuries after that, and the inheritance we have today to have the opportunity to participate in this as well. We give you thanks in worship for what you have done, and we pray that you continue to guide us in the years ahead for how we may bring mutual aid to others, how we may love others in the radical way that you loved us through your Son, Jesus. And as we pray these things, we remember those who might not be with us today, who might be ill or in need. We give you thanks for tributes to life, such as the one for Walter Dick recently. We celebrate the saints and the sinners that you have raised and given us in our community. We focus on all of these things and worship your holy name in your Son's name. Amen. Please stand with us as we sing. Let me check the bulletin here. Please stand as we sing number 809, Sing a New World into Being.
Thank you.
But God has placed before you life and death, blessings and curses. Therefore, choose life. Follow God's way. Go now and be a people of reconciliation and integrity. May your yes be yes and your no be no. And in all the paths you walk, may God hold you steady and close. May Christ Jesus bless you in every place you enter. And may the Spirit give you length of days and fullness of life. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.